When it comes to dating, for a lot of people, there's a big question on their mind. Should I date? The answer? No.
That's all, folks.
Of course, we're just kidding. But answering the question of dating is complicated and more nuanced than we might think. It might not even be the right question to begin with.
In our world today, love and romance are a big deal. They're in our movies, our TV shows, our books, and of course, the music we listen to.
I'll be honest, looking at you got me thinking nonsense. Cartwheels in my stomach when you walk in. When you got your arms around me, oh, it feels so good. I had to jump the octave. I think I got an X, but I've forgotten. And I can't find my chill, I must have lost it. I don't even know I'm talking nonsense. I'm talking.
But why is romance such a big deal? Let's talk about that question with the people around us.
To really begin the conversation about dating, we want to focus on two main answers to this question. First, it could be because our culture emphasizes it so much and has emphasized it for such a long time. Shakespeare was comparing his love to a summer's day in the 16th century.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all too short a note.
And that isn't all that different from the Beatles singing about being in love.
Baby said she's mine, you know, she tells me all the time, you know, she said so. I'm in love with her and I feel fine.
Which isn't all that different from BTS and Coldplay singing about someone being their universe.
But it's not just about a general sense of love. We also see fictional romantic relationships in our culture. And like it or not, these relationships teach us about love and romance. This also isn't a new thing. In the same ways, there's really not that much difference between Casablanca.
What about us?
We'll always have Paris. We didn't have, we lost it until you came to Casablanca. We got it back last night.
When I said I would never leave you.
And you never will.
And Pride and Prejudice?
I have fought against my better judgment, my family's expectation, the inferiority of your birth, my rank and circumstance, all these things, and I'm willing to put them aside and ask you to end my agony.
I don't understand.
I love you. Most ardently.
And New Girl.
Oh, come on, please go faster. I gotta tell my best friend I'm in love with her.
Shower first. I never seen anyone sweat so much.
You take a shower. You smell terrible.
Yeah, you smell terrible.
Hey, Miller.
Hey.
So our culture puts a lot of emphasis on love and romantic relationships, but it's worth admitting that what we see aren't always the best examples. Take the super popular Love is Blind series on Netflix. The primary thrust of the show is to prove that love is, well, blind, that people can fall in love without physical-based attraction. But what ends up happening isn't always quite so idealistic.
I listened to what my heart was saying and I listened to what my gut was saying and they were aligned. And the connection that I have with Irina, she makes me feel so loved. And she has since we met each other. The way she just makes me feel so special when we talk to each other. I want to marry someone who's marrying me because they love who I am as a person.
2 hours later.
I just feel like we're in this hole. We're trying to like get out of it and get out of it. And it's like, it's only like, I feel like we're only going to end up like resenting ourselves. This is supposed to be like our honeymoon phase. Like,
and it's been horrible.
If I can name my favorite, it's like me talking to Paul for 5 minutes. Like, I was so inspired and excited about our conversation. And I was like, why haven't I had one of these conversations with Zach?
There's also shows like The Button that can feel fairly mean-spirited and can highlight some of humanity's most selfish tendencies.
I'm a very creative person, I guess. My life is never, oh my gosh, because I'm a creative person?
No, I just, you're not cute, sorry.
Ouch.
I'm not cute?
But remember, we're wanting to answer the question of why romance is such a big deal in our world. Even if our culture gives us some strange perspectives of romance and love, we know at our roots, we were designed for human connection.
This is the second answer why love and romance is such an inescapable force in our world. It's hardwired in us. When God created the world, the one thing he said was not good was that man was alone. We all want to be seen, known, and loved. Dallas Willard puts it this way. The greatest thing you and I can imagine is the fellowship of other loving persons, to love and to be loved, to enjoy, to be with, to adventure, to create.
For many people, they believe they'll find that sort of connection inside a romantic relationship. To be fair, no matter where we're at, perpetually single, in between relationships, or madly in love with our partners, it's hard to deny that there's something uniquely powerful about the feelings we feel inside a romance. We're gonna talk about dating throughout this entire conversation kit, but in this first episode, we want to start at the start, the initial stages of a relationship.
To begin, let's talk about the building block of dating, the date. With the people around you, answer this question. What is a date?
You may have noticed that dates and dating can be pretty confusing. Does getting coffee with that cute boy I like count as a date? I mean, he never called it a date, but we were hanging out alone, and I like him. Also, he did pay for my coffee.
Or is the girl I've been texting for 2 hours before bed every night my girlfriend? She never said she was, but she doesn't seem to be talking to anybody else, and I feel a pretty strong affection toward her. Maybe she's just using me for my exhaustive Lego collection.
Beginning a dating relationship can come with a lot of anxiety and overthinking. It can be scary, awkward, and potentially painful to tell someone you're interested in them. But it also isn't great to get stuck in a situationship.
Someone asked me what a situationship is, so I kindly explained. I said a situationship is when two people are attracted to each other and they start hanging out. They're maybe talking to each other every day, texting, sending photos, gifts, all the joys. But then one day, one of them realizes, it's been 4 months, I've met his friends, I've met his family, and we even have nicknames for each other. We're surely dating. So I told him what happens is that person figures out what's going on, but they end up never bringing it up with the other person. And then all of a sudden, we're at month like number 10, and they still don't know for sure if they're in a relationship.
We don't think dating, even in high school, is necessarily a bad thing, but it can be unhealthy for some people. Dating can bring out the best and the worst in us. The situationship is a good example of this. When you peel back the layers, what they really are is someone looking for the emotional benefits of a deep, committed relationship without any of the risk. Put simply, they're using the other person.
We'll talk more about unhealthy tendencies and red flags in our next episode, but for now, it's worth talking about the foundations of a healthy relationship.
This is where we need to turn to the Bible. The Bible is very positive about romance and relationships. Remember, God created us male and female. both equally human, both equally in God's image, both fearfully and wonderfully made, but also unique in form and function, compatible for relationships spiritually, emotionally, and sexually. The charge of God to Adam and Eve in the garden is to be fruitful and multiply.
We won't beat around the bush. God is explicitly blessing a sexual union between a husband and wife. So it's not surprising when we see marriage and intimacy celebrated throughout the whole Bible. On top of this, intimacy is also an image of God's desire to be with us, and us with Him. So God often describes His relationship with us through the metaphor of a lover chasing after their love. This is one of the interpretations of Song of Songs.
The Song of Songs, a love poem between a man and a woman, and it'll make you blush.
Yeah, on its basic level of meaning, this book is racy Hebrew love poetry. But remember, in Proverbs, humanity's pursuit of wisdom was portrayed with the symbolism of a man pursuing a woman in a garden.
But in this song, it's the woman who's searching and longing for her lover.
Yes, it's a poetic image of Lady Wisdom pursuing us so that we can have life. In fact, the song ends with a poem about how this lady's love is more powerful than death itself.
So the song works on two levels. It's celebrating humans' desire for intimacy.
And saying that that desire points to humanity's ultimate purpose, to be united with God and His wisdom.
So the Bible blesses romance, but there's a small problem. It doesn't really say anything about dating. And why would it? If we look back at history, dating is a pretty new thing. But even if the Bible doesn't give any direct advice for dating, much of what it teaches about humanity and relationships can be helpful as we step into dating relationships.
The first thing we can learn from the biblical perspective is that one of the goals, if not the goal, of dating is marriage, to see if the person you're attracted to could be a potential spouse in the future. We want to be very clear. We're not saying that if you start dating someone at 16, you're committing to marrying them in the future. That would make dating all the more intense and scary and put a lifetime of pressure and responsibility on yourself and the person you're dating.
The result of this sort of pressure could be saying things you don't mean and making decisions with consequences that last longer than the relationship. As someone gets older, they might shift their dating habits to be much more intentional, but in high school, you don't have to think of the person you're dating as your guaranteed future husband or wife.
What we are saying is that when you date, you should be paying attention to your partner. Who are they? What do they believe? How do they treat you? Do they have good qualities and similar values to you?
On top of this, you should be paying attention to yourself. Are you overly attached or emotionally distant? Have you become a better person since you started dating? Are you seeing more fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, and kindness in your life? Do you feel like you're having to change who you are to maintain their approval? Or are you feeling more confident, safe, and secure?
In a healthy relationship, you should be getting to know your partner and developing a deeper understanding of yourself. Relationships are always revealing. So even if that relationship doesn't last until marriage, it could make you a better date and maybe even a better spouse in the future.
All of the girls you loved before made you the one I've fallen for. Every day that street led you straight to me. Now you're all I need. I'm so thankful for all of the girls you loved before. But I love you more.
It's worth saying that the foundation of a healthy dating relationship is usually set well before the two people even start dating. This is because in the order of priority, dating, or marriage for that matter, is not the most important relationship. Your relationship with God is. As Dr. Henry Cloud and Dr. John Townsend point out in their book, Boundaries in Dating, the issue is not how to fit our spiritual life into our dating life. Rather, it is how to fit our dating life into our spiritual life.
Essentially, what this means is that you should always be prioritizing your relationship with Jesus. This looks like spending time in prayer, reading the Bible, attending church, and pursuing friends who encourage you to chase after Jesus. Even if this seems like a Christian cliche, it helps us to become healthier and sets us up for more successful romantic relationships in the future.
In his first letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul says, "Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things."
There's a lot that can and has been said about this section of scripture, and if you're curious about qualities to pursue in a dating relationship, it doesn't get much better. But in our fallenness, our love won't always look like this, which is why we need to be connected to the very source of love.
When Paul wrote 1 Corinthians 13, he wasn't just making up something that sounded poetic. He was writing based on the example of Jesus, who, despite being single, loved others with patience and kindness and humility. We are called to love like Jesus, and we need to know him to accomplish that.
So what does this mean for our lives and our dating relationships? Let's just say somebody's caught your eye. You've got a crush. What should you do? It might seem weird, but the first thing to do is pray. The power of prayer when it comes to relationships cannot be overstated.
Oswald Chambers is attributed with saying, "We pray when there's nothing else we can do, but God wants us to pray before we do anything at all. Pray that the Lord would give you wisdom and guide your choices." In fact, we should be praying that consistently throughout our romantic relationships.
The next thing you should do is begin seeking the perspectives of older and wiser people, people who know you, but have also walked through relationships. Ask what they think of the person and whether or not they think you should pursue the relationship. They'll be able to see your blind spots and let you know if it's a wise choice or not.
Inviting the people who know us best to speak into our relationships is going to set us up for success. They can help us realize if we're stepping into a relationship for the wrong reasons. Our infatuation with another person can blind us sometimes.
But if you've walked through these steps and are feeling like they would be a good person to date, talk to them about it. In our next episode, we'll talk a little about what healthy and unhealthy dating relationships can look like. But for now, it's important to remember that healthy dating relationships often begin well before the relationship itself. It begins with being a healthy person and finding someone who is also healthy.
We hope you enjoyed this Conversation Kit episode. At Access, we're passionate about creating resources that help connect parents and caring adults with the teens in their lives, empowering them to have intentional conversations on important topics and deepening their faith in Jesus. That's why we call them Conversation Kits. Access is a donor-supported organization, so we need partners like you to continue to make videos like this possible. If you would like to join us, you can click the Give button in the top right corner of our website, access.org, to give a gift of support today. Thanks for being a part of our mission.